his young life and how he got to be such a great example. So one of the traits that I found the most admirable about the Prophet lies in his humble beginning. As you may know, he left his father before he was born, and then his mother soon after, and spent most of his life living with his uncle. Even through the struggles of having to grow up orphan, the Prophet was respectful or filled with hatred. He did not have anybody to give him guidance on what was right or wrong, like we have to do today. Yet he always seemed to choose the right path. People who are against the religion of Islam often try to find or point out faults of the Prophet Muhammad. However, they're usually successful, as he lived a very admirable lifestyle. The way that the Prophet lived provides a lesson for anyone that uses their background as an excuse for their actions. As we see many times in today's society, people will blame their bad actions on their backgrounds, how they were raised, how they grew up. However, the Prophet was a living example of how someone could embody good character even through hardship. So many people I have heard tell me that they couldn't possibly be like the Prophet because he was a prophet, and they say that they're just ordinary people, so it wouldn't be possible. However, in Surah Kahf, verse 110, the Quran says, "Say, O Muhammad, I am but a man like yourself, but the inspiration has come to me that your Allah is one Allah." The significance of this ayat lies in the fact that it basically says that the Prophet was a normal man. He was just human, he wasn't some godly being, he was human just like you and me. So that needs to show us that what made him special was his devotion to the religion of Islam, and that basically, since the Prophet was human, just like the rest of us, it shows we can all aspire to be like him. It's an attainable goal, and that we cannot make any excuses, because since he was human, that means that we are able to do exactly as he did.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. My name is Ruby Khan, and I'm a high school sophomore. Prophet Muhammad Khan is a paragon for spiritual life in Islam. However, his spirituality precedes his first reception of his first revelation of God. Even before he became a messenger of Allah, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a man of God. Many people don't know about his life before, and they just assume that it was just before and unrelated, but it's so related to his status as a prophet. Muhammad, peace be upon him's life began not when he was 40 years old, but when he was a child. About his pre-Islamic life are not commonly known, but they're really indicative of Muhammad, peace be upon him's goodness of the heart and his thoughtfulness for how even before he was introduced to Allah's direct guidance, he was following the path to Allah. Muhammad received revelations that spoke the direct words of God, but his whole being as a messenger of God, reveals messages from Allah that are conveyed through his actions. The integrity of his actions before his revelation prove why he was chosen as the messenger of God to all of humanity. When Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a child, he was recognized as an exceptional member of his clan, and many believe that he became their leader. He had a somewhat unique aura that set aside others of the tribe. According to Muslim traditions, the Hunafa, or believers of one God, were all waiting for the arrival of a new prophet. Muhammad, peace be upon him, was that said prophet. However, he was discovered when he was 12, not 40. His uncle Abu Talib invited him along in his merchant caravan. The Persian monk Bahira noticed a cloud falling in the caravan, shielding them from blistering heat. He was intrigued. He invited Abu Talib to share a meal to observe the phenomena further. He noticed the young Muhammad and took him aside and asked him a variety of questions about his life, about his social standing, his family, background, his personal hopes and dreams. Finally, Bahira asked to see Muhammad, peace be upon him's back. There, in between his two shoulder blades, he found Khatam an-Nubuwa, the seal of prophethood, indicated by his skin growth. Only at the age of 12, Muhammad, peace be upon him, was being protected by a miracle of a cloud trying to raise a son from him. Also, he wore a physical brand of prophethood. Muhammad was destined to be in service of Allah almost 30 years before he was designated as prophet. As Muhammad, peace be upon him, advanced through adulthood, he experienced the simple blessings of life, such as a marriage, a stable career, and children. But even before becoming Allah's official messenger, his experiences were not the basic
or average ones his contemporaries had had. He was known and always acknowledged for his virtuous character. He became a traitor. He built a reputation of not only being efficient, but honest, gaining him the title of Sadiq al-Amin, meaning the truthful, the trustworthy. Khadija bint Khuwaylid, one of the wealthiest traders of Mecca, heard of Sadiq al-Amin and ventured to test the abilities of his farm by asking him to sell some of her goods in Syria. Although the servant of hers, Mersara, ordered him to tell the advice. Mersara relayed the information and exposed the Prophet a man like no other, overwhelming virtue and honesty. Khadija, a wealthy, beautiful woman of a respectable lineage, recognized the exceptional traits Muhammad alone had, regardless of his social and economic differences, and she proposed a marriage. Khadija recognized his virtuous abilities that made him the messenger of God even before he was dubbed. Muhammad, peace be upon him, had six children with Khadija, but he also had an adopted son, Zayd. Zayd began a slave after he was captured in battle and had several masters before Khadija and then Muhammad. He had been serving Muhammad for several years and he discovered his family still alive. They came to Muhammad and requested to purchase Zayd back. Muhammad asked Zayd to make the decision himself. If he wanted to go with his family, he was free to, without compensation. But if he chose to stay, his family would have to accept his choice. Unexpectedly, Zayd preferred slavery, not because he enjoyed the service, but because he enjoyed serving Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Zayd also recognized the unique and honorable qualities Muhammad, peace be upon him, possessed, and would much rather be in the presence of such a man than away. Directly after the moving decision, Muhammad immediately freed Zayd and publicly adopted him as his son. Now, Zayd ibn Muhammad had recognized the remarkable traits of Muhammad and made a decision that would affect him for life that he knew he would not regret. An important episode in his life before prophethood also has great implications for American Muslims. There was a merchant who came to perform a pilgrimage to Mecca, but was subsequently robbed of all of his possessions. He turned to many for help, but received no aid from anyone. Several leaders in Mecca, including Muhammad, peace be upon him, had heard of his plight and were shocked to not only hear what had occurred, but also that no one would help him. The well-meaning leaders collaborated on what they called Hilf al-Fudul, a pact of the virtuous. They created three creeds to follow. No person will be subjected to persecution, regardless of whether he or she is a native of Mecca or an outsider. Two, from now on, there will be no opportunities for cruelty to occur. Three, we'll push for the rights of the downtrodden until they're obtained. Later in Muhammad, peace be upon him's life, he said if he was once again invited to join such a league, now as Prophet of Islam, he would. The significance of such an allegiance is monumental. First, it shows how Muhammad, as a founding member among others, took initiative to improve Mecca's living condition. Then, it shows how the values of rights are being defined in a time they were looked over. And it also shows the acceptance of non-Muslims and that together, non-Muslims and Muslims can collaborate to make something great. The pact vows to protect the rights and prevent oppression of people regardless of their religion or where they're from, something our world has little trouble doing. This pact was marvelous on so many levels, and the American Muslims could learn a lot from it. We should not feel afraid or reluctant to join groups or organizations to protect the civil liberties of others. Overall, Muhammad, peace be upon him, has always followed the path of righteousness without ever being told to do so. His whole life was recognized by Muslims and non-Muslims alike for his unique and wonderful belief in being a good person. His graciousness made him the man who became the messenger of Allah in the way of his words and also in the way of his actions. Muhammad is an epitome for not only Muslims, but also shows how he connects to non-Muslims alike and how, as a messenger of God, Allah shows what he expects out of humanity by pointedly telling it through the Quran, but also through the hadith of Muhammad, peace be upon him, that show righteousness in action. Muhammad was an exceptional individual, and his whole life all of his interactions and choices are a model for humanity. Thank you.
Assalamualaikum. My name is Adija Azam, and I'm currently a high school senior. I would just like to start by congratulating all of you for being able to make it to this blessed Mehfil and conference to talk about the one thing that we love more than we love anything else in this world, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Love is a beautiful emotion.
Every relationship and every connection becomes stronger, more durable when you add love to it. Beginning with our first love as a child for our mother to the love that we share with our friends and family today. When you love someone, they're always on your mind and you put their wishes above your own. You love to follow them, do whatever pleases them, and you try not to displease them or break their heart. You share with them your problems and you consult them. Their name soothes you and their company is the most precious time of your day. So why not should we have these feelings for our Prophet, the one reason that we have Islam in our lives, the one reason that we know our way to heaven? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a blessing upon mankind, a living, walking representation as to what it means to be a Muslim, whether it be 1400 years ago or in the 21st century. His character shows us the ways of Islam, and following his sunnah is one of the easiest ways to become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it so easy for us to be good Muslims, yet unfortunately, we as humans make so many mistakes and put our worldly desires higher than our love for our Prophet. But one of the easiest ways that we can find our way back is just to follow his sunnah. Doing small acts like sitting when you drink water, or using three fingers to eat when you eat with your hand, or even having dinner together with other people is a sunnah of the Prophet. It was once recorded that the Prophet Muhammad said, "A person will not be a true Muslim until he loves me more than he loves anything else in the world." There are many ways to express your love, as in sitting together and just remembering the great things that he brought upon to mankind. Others look into stories about his life or stories that the Sahaba have said about him. Or others just send their durood and salam to him in their hearts or with their mouths. One way that many of us have expressed our love is just by sitting in this conference, just sitting together and talking about the greatness that the Prophet has brought upon mankind. I pray that we... It is said that on the day of judgment, you will be raised with those that you love. So if you love worldly desires, you will be raised with those who have loved this dunya. And it is said that those people are not the ones who reach heaven. The people who reach heaven are the ones that love the Prophet or love the people who love the Prophet. I pray that we are all raised as a part of the Ummah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the Day of Judgment, and that we all find the love that is in our hearts for him. I pray that we improve our actions to mimic those of the Prophet, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us become better Muslims so that we may reach the gates of heaven on the Day of Judgment.
Amen. MashaAllah, that was very informative, and I think like Rahan mentioned at the beginning of the program, I think we did make history tonight, right? Successfully completed the first women-only panel, alhamdulillah. Again, JazakumAllahu Khairan. Please give a big round of applause to our panelists here.
Okay, now let's move on. I think I'm going to speak without the mic, the big echo. Can you all hear me? The last one. So now I'd like to welcome Dr. Muqtada Khan, who needs no introduction, but again for the guest here, I would like to introduce him. He's a professor at UD in the Department of Political Science and International Relations, and also founding director of the Islamic Studies at UD. He's also a co-founder of Delaware Council on Global and Muslim Affairs. So today, tonight, he's going to reflect on
one of the beautiful ayahs of the Quran, وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِي وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا, and one who invites to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by his permission, like a luminescent lamp. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Muqtada Khan.
Shukran.
Shukran.
As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sisters, can you hear me in the back? Okay, so I don't think I will try mute. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasul, salamu alayka, ya Nabi, salamu alayka, ya Habib, salamu alayka, salawatullah alayka. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Inna Allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi, ya ayyuhallazina amanu sallu alayhi sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Mawlana Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidum majid. All of you are familiar with that particular ayah from the Quran. It is one of the most unique in all religious perspectives. and it has puzzled to a great extent Muslim commentators who have struggled to understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means when he says that he and his angels send prayers upon his prophets. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also said the same about us in the Quran. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said the same thing about us in the Quran in Surah Al-Ahzab. He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. هُوَ الَّذِي يُسَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ لِيُخْرِجُكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ وَكَانَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that He and His angels also send blessings upon all of us, ordinary people. Why do they send peace and blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? But He says that this blessings that He and His angels send are intended at extracting us from darkness into light. And He is benevolent and compassionate over all believers. So the question really comes repeatedly in the Quran as to what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mean by this ayah that He extracts us from darkness into light. There are many themes in the Quran about light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Himself as light. Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. Allah is also the creator of light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also describes the Quran as light. But in many ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also describes Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as light. But before I explain that to you and discuss the concept of Siraj al-Muniran in the Quran and what it means when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a luminous lamp, I want to remind you about the story or the tradition that we recite about At-Tahiyyat. I don't know how many of you know, we recite At-Tahiyyat in all our salawat, in all our prayers. As Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. At-Tahiyyat lillahi wa salawatu wa tayyibatu. As-salamu alayka ayyuha al-Nabiyy wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi s-salihin. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. According to tradition, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the night of Miraj approached Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he met Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the thing that he said, first thing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. So the At-Tahiyyat is essentially a dialogue between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his angels. So the first sentence of the At-Tahiyyat, it is At-Tahiyyatu lillahi wa salawatu wa tayyibatu. This is what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At-Tahiyyat means, Tahiyya means to greet, send greetings, to send compliments. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam essentially said, all compliments, At-Tahiyyatu lillahi, and prayers and worship are for you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All praise, all worship, all zikr, all salawat are for you alone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the first thing Prophet Muhammad, as a human being who is living on earth, says this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to him by saying, As-salamu alayka ayyuha al-Nabiyyu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Peace be upon you, O Prophet, and Allah's mercy and blessings are upon you. This majlis today is gathering today is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of His angels. We are here copying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His angels. We are trying to replicate that majlis in heaven where Allah and His angels recite salawat on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are trying to do that here. Alhamdulillah. And I'm extremely grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has given this opportunity to literally create heaven on earth in Delaware. But Allah subhanahu, and then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives His salam to him, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam responds by saying, "Assalamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi salihin." He says, "Peace be upon us and all good slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Peace be upon us. He doesn't respond by saying "Assalamu." He's not saying that peace is from him alone. He's saying "Assalamu alayna" upon all of us. And to me, this is so wonderful that in this greatest moment in his life,
Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam when he meets Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. This is not just the greatest moment in his life, but this is the greatest moment in the history of humanity, where someone who is representing human beings is actually encountering Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala and having a dialogue. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam remembers to remember us. He remembers us when he says, "Assalamu alayna." So there may be peace and blessings upon us. And for this alone, for this one act alone, all our lives we have to be grateful to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The more durood we recite, the more we praise him. I mean, in his greatest moment, he didn't forget us. So how can we forget him in any of our moments in our life? So that is very important. That's why I'm telling you this story of At-Tahiyyat, to remind you that he never forgot us. Even if, you know, it's like saying, if you meet somebody important, I don't know who you think is important, but whoever you think is important, you meet that person, do you even remember your family or anybody else? You're so busy telling them about yourself, trying to impress them about who you are. But the Prophet greets him, and then he remembers us. And the angels then say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu. I'm so jealous of these angels who were witness to this incredible moment. And the only thing that they could do was to testify to this reality that there is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one God, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger on earth. Coming back to the ayah that I want to talk to you all about today, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, this is Surah Al-Ahzab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhun nabi, inna arsalnaka shahidam wa mubashiram nadhiram. O my Prophet, O my Nabi, indeed I have sent you as shahidan, as a witness, as mubashiram, as someone who brings good tidings, and as someone who is nazir, who is a warner. So in this way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is defining the portfolio of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His job is to be a witness. So he is shahid to what? He is bearing witness to us that there is only Allah. He's bearing witness to us that Allah has sent the Quran through him. And then he's bearing witness to Allah that we are his slaves. So that's why the reference to At-Tahiyyat, As-Salaamu Alayna, peace be upon us who are pious servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are reminded that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the witness. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَدَعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِيِزْمِهِ وَسِرَاجًا مُنِينًا. And he invites people to the way of Allah. He invites people to the way of Allah with the permission of Allah as a luminescent lamp, as a lamp that is radiant by itself. Now this ayah is very beautiful. Anas ibn Malik, one who says something very interesting about this ayah, says that when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Mecca, the day Mecca surrendered, he says it was illuminated, it was glowing. You know, that's why when we refer to Medina, we say Medina Munawwar, that which is an enlightened city. But it is enlightened because Sirajul Muniran used to live there, because Prophet Muhammad used to live there, and it is his light which radiated in Medina, which made Medina this enlightened or illuminated or munawwar city. But he said something very interesting, which I actually read for the first time today, and I was quite frightened. He says, on the day Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, he said, Medina was dark. He said, not only was Medina dark, even before we finished burying him, our hearts changed. Yeah. I really wanted to cry when I heard that. He says that even before the Sahaba had finished burying Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, their hearts changed. What does it mean that the hearts changed? What it means is that we had lost the light which illuminated us. We lost that light which brought Iman to us. So in the other ayah that I was talking about, لِيُخْرِجُكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ, it extracts us from darkness and brings us into light. That light has turned off on the day he died. And this is not some interpretation I'm giving you. one of the Prophet Ali who left me at his behind. So what does Siraj al-Muniran mean? There are several other things. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, it has come, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ, it has come to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a light and a clear book. A light and a clear book. And if you read the entire ayah, it basically is talking about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, for people of the scripture, there has come to you our messenger, making clear to you much of what you used to conceal of the scripture and overlooking much. It is addressing essentially Jews and Christians and saying, for people of the book, we have sent you a messenger. We have sent you a light. So what is the point that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like saying that we have sent you a map and a country. Here's the map, tells you where to go, and here's the light which will lead you in the right direction. And that is where it is important for us, for those who argue that we cannot practice our faith by separating the Quran from the Sunnah. We cannot. Because people think that the Quran is the light. But if that was the case, then in this ayah at least Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not have redundancy. Says, we have said you, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورًا وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. كِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ is the Quran, the clear book. And it is clear because of the light. You understand? It is clear because of the light of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, I want to step back and tell you why we have gone to this trouble, and I want to congratulate everybody who helped us set this up. It is important for us to have our traditions. There is no flavor in faith without tradition. Tradition brings flavor. Islam is a composite of love and law. If we just obsess about Sharia and Sharia compliance, then the religion is reduced to law, and love is lost. If you just focus on the book, then you inadvertently focus on the law. But in order to bring love in our life, we have to also think of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and bring these traditions back into our life. But America is very different from, Delaware is different from Lahore or Hyderabad or even Cairo. So we cannot simply import the same traditions that we practice back home here. To give you a funny example, it would be like Indians coming to America and deciding to wear dhotis because they wore dhotis back home. Here you will freeze your winter. Have to change your clothes. What you used to wear in Tanzania or Ghana in the hot tropical, you cannot do that. So traditions are also like that. They have to adapt to the lives here. One of the characteristics of the Muslim community in the United States is it's highly educated. You can see our next generation, mashallah. They are all from here. And you saw how confident, how enlightened, how educated, how articulate they are. So the traditions that we import have to be adopted. And I believe very strongly that these traditions will take root and survive into our next generation if they are knowledge-based traditions. If they are knowledge-based, they draw on the knowledge of the faith and they empower us. Prophet ﷺ used to say, you are a loser if you are the same person 2 days in a row. And I like that word, Farsi loser, literally, it is actually translated as loser. I'm not taking any poetic freedom in translating, it means a loser. Prophet Muhammad meant that you are a loser if you are the same person 2 days in a row, which means you have to become a better person. You have to constantly work at improving yourself. And the leverage, the lever, the instrument of change is knowledge. Is the knowledge that is required. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this knowledge can also, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us with the kitab, the nur can also be our power, our capacity to reason. So it is very important that when we import traditions from back home, we also adapt them for societies here. And that's why we are trying to do these events in English, and that's why we are trying to embed them with a strong content of knowledge, so that we become at least more knowledgeable persons at the end of the day. And for those of you who know that in the people of Ahlul Tasawwuf recognize that there can be no love without knowing. To love someone is to know someone. And if you want to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you cannot love him if you don't know him. Who are you in love with? A stranger? You know, there is a literature called Shama'il literature, which just about the physical appearance of Prophet Muhammad. There are books and books written about just the physical appearance of Rasulullah. I can see a couple of brothers here whose hairstyle is like Rasulullah in this room right now. How do we know that that was his hairstyle from this literature? How do we know what his demeanor was? So it's very important that even if we are trying to hide ourselves as Ashiq or Rasul or whatever people like to call themselves, you cannot be ghafil about the realities of the Prophet's life. You can't be jealous about the seer of Rasulullah and then say, I am Ashiq Rasulullah. Because there is no love without knowledge. And that is something you must understand. So when people ask this question about, you know, the people of Ahlul Tasawwuf say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was a hidden treasure. He wanted to be known, he wanted to be loved, so he created us so that we may know him and we may love him. And there's a lot of critique that this is not in the Quran. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the only reason why I have created human beings and jinns is to worship him, and then the same argument, you cannot worship that which you do not know, and you cannot know that, you cannot love that which you do not know. So the same argument applies to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this whole idea of diving deep into the seerah of Prophet Muhammad. If he is our role model, then we need to know how he lived. A lot of us in Islamic studies and religious are obsessed with what Prophet Muhammad said. That's a good thing. We need to know what he did in order to know who he is. But I think that in this day and age, practicing sunnah is not focusing on what he did, but asking the question, what would Prophet Muhammad do in the situation that I am in? What would he do, not what he did? So in the first case, to know what he did, you just need ilm, knowledge. But in order to know what he would do, you need and I don't use fiqh as a legal, fiqh misunderstanding in Arabic. So you need to have a fahm of his personality. You have to have a person. So it's like saying, okay, in such a situation, this is what he would do. And you know, in our casual conversations, we always talk about how, like, my son, his name is Rumi, and he's been gone for 3-4, inshallah, he's arriving there. So, for the last 3 months, me and my wife, we think, oh, this is what Rumi would do today. No. This is what Rumi would say. Because we know him, we love him, so we are able to guess. He may not do that, he may surprise us. But in order to be able to answer the question, what would Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam do in this moment, in this situation, we have to have a deep understanding of his personality, of his character, of his choices, of his values. Those are important things for us to know. And we can know those things only by trying to develop in-depth understanding of Prophet Muhammad's life. One day a Sahabi came to Aisha radiallahu anha and says, can you describe to Ali? He was not a Sahabi because he had not met the Prophet. So it was Tabi and he asked, can you describe to me the personality of Prophet Muhammad? And Aisha told him, have you not seen the Quran? That is the personality of Prophet Muhammad. And I'm sure a lot of you have heard this many times. And I've heard it many times growing up in India. But I never really, that's where people stop. They tell me this hadith and then they move on. Sometimes this hadith is used to glorify the Quran, as if it needs glorification. Sometimes this hadith is used to glorify the personality of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by elevating it to the status of that of the Quran. But what does it really mean to say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's personality is like that of the Quran? One of the Quran is the best explanation of the Quran. You all know that, right? That's why the best tafsir of the Quran is tafsir bil Quran. So what does the Quran have to say about the Quran? The Quran has many names by which it addresses the Quran, such as that's one name of the Quran. Kitabun Mubin, book which is clear, and so on and so forth, zikr is. But one name of the Quran, in the Quran, is Furqan. The Quran is Furqan. So what does the word Furqan mean? Furqan means the criteria by which you distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. That is the Quran, which will tell you what is sahih, what is ghalat, what is halal, what is haram, what is zahir, what is batin. You can distinguish between all of these things. So when Aisha said the Prophet ﷺ's personality is like a Quran, she's saying he is Furqan. So what does it mean to be Furqan? And so, this is the challenge. To be able to practice Sunnah today, as Muslims, we have to develop in ourselves the capacity of Furqan. Then you are like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not because of the beard, not because of the clothes, not because of that is fine. We are developing good habits by trying to be like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the real challenge is to develop that mental and moral attitude that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam embodied. So to be Furqan is to be able to have the capacity to judge what is right, what is wrong. That is the highest form. It is to be arifin. As Ibn Sina used to say, he used to talk about three levels of believers. One is the abbot, who is just a slave. And then the zahid, who just loves. And then the arif, with whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shares his secrets. To know. And to know is to be like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shared most of his secrets with Rasulullah. And what we know of Allah, we know because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that. So the goal of those who say that they love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we want to bring the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have to educate our next generation to essentially develop the capacity to becoming moral agents. To develop this moral capacity to distinguish between what is haq and what is not. What is right and what is wrong. Once they learn this capacity, then they will live righteous lives, because their conscience will not let them live bad lives. Because we have developed this instrument in their hearts which teaches them to be Furqan. That is why I think it is very important that all of us, every mawlid, every opportunity that we get, we add knowledge about the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his seerah, and reflections upon episodes. Many of us know a lot of his life. But to think about those things. I'm going to end by discussing an ayah which I've been struggling with for many years. Every year I make this resolution that this time I will do a khutbah on this ayah. There are many people who have done their khutbahs. I have listened to all of them. The best one so far I found is Yasa Qadi. There are lots of people who have written even books on this ayah. This is Ayatul Nur, the 35th ayah of Surah Nur. In fact, Shaykh Imam Ghazali actually wrote a book on it, Ishqaq al-Anwar. The whole book is just on this one ayah, called Ayatul Nur. I'm going to share a little bit of it, and it's very important for you to understand in the light of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's seerah, why this ayah is very important. It is quite possible that the explanations that I'm going to offer to you are all wrong, because these are offered by human beings, and there is no direct hadith explaining this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Allah wa nuru samawati wal ard.
Allah is the light of heaven and the earth.
The tradition says that Allah subhanahu Allah created his entire creation in darkness. He created his entire creation in darkness. And then created Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his light. With his own light, he created Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is the light of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sirajan Muniran, which then illuminated creation. And it came up, it popped up. Otherwise it was in darkness, invisible. So it illuminated itself because of that light. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you say is the light of the heavens and the earth, is also the creator of the light that we see in the heavens and the earth, and also the creator of the light of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Masala nurihi ka mishkawatim fiha misbahum. Take the example of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's light. It's like a lamp in a niche. Mishkawatim, it's a niche in which there is a lamp. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-mistahu fi zujjaja. This lamp is in a glass. It's surrounded by a glass. I actually went and checked whether zujjaja means glass. It actually means glass. Glass was discovered 5,000 years ago, so there were lots of. It was in fact manufacturing on a mass level of production by 600 AD, by the time the Quran was revealed, everybody knew what Zujjaja was. So it's an interesting thing to know. Al-Mizdah fi Zujjaja, Az-Zujjaja tu ka'annahu kawkaban durriyu yuhad min shadarati mubarakah. So it says that, so you have a niche. You know, niches, in masajid you see like a hole in the wall. Right, where the people keep books, etc. That is a niche, like a small bookshelf built into the wall. In that there is a lamp. That lamp is in glass. And in that lamp, there is an oil that comes from a very special tree. Okay? And that tree is itself a blessing. So, Shajaratin Mubarakah. This is a blessed Mubarak. Zaytunatin la sharqiyatin wa la gharbiyatin. Yakudu Zaituha Yudiyu Walau Lam Tam Sasahu Nar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying about this that whose oil would glow almost by itself. So this is a lamp inside a glass. And inside that lamp there is an oil which comes from a blessed tree. And this oil is so blessed that it could glow by itself. So it is glowing. So you have a lamp with oil in it which is glowing, and you have light in it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nurun ala nur, there is light upon light. Now this is the most difficult part. When you say nurun ala nur, is it the light of Allah and the light of Rasulullah? Or is the first light Rasulullah and the second light is the light of the Iman of Rasulullah? So there is a lot of speculative aspects about this. Yahdi Allahu li nurihi man yashahu. Allah Ta'ala guides to his light whoever he wants. This is where he breaks my heart. Because now I am dependent on him wanting to see me. That's why I have not understood the meaning of this light. This ayah for the last 2-3 years that I've been struggling is because I'm waiting for the moment when Allah feels pity on me and says, okay, I'm going to explain it to you now. I will guide you to my light. And then you will understand this ayah for me. Please do dua for me. وَيَدْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يَكُونُ خَيْرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this whole example is important. Some sahaba think that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that مَسَلَ نُورِهِ, saying that the example of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's light, which we do not see, is Rasulullah. He's an example of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's light. And this lamp is Rasulullah. And this part of the oil is the heart of the Prophet. And the oil comes from the tree which is blessed, which is the family tree of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So the light which was given to Ibrahim alayhi salam, the blessed light, is the same light which has been given to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the niche is like Rasulullah and the heart. So these are the metaphors. But what is important for us to understand is
to give you a very simple understanding is that light is something which is spiritual in nature. It is our spirituality, which is the light. So our spirituality is our approximation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our desire to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is our spiritual one. And our desire to come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires a light, a travel. We are light years away from Him. And we can come to Him through traveling at the speed of light, which is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the important part. And that is why we cannot be good Muslims if we remain alienated to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to be connected to Him. We have to be like this. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam described people who love Him will be like this with Him on the Day of Judgment and in heaven. And that's how we have to be like Him. But you must not forget that all of this is a wasila in order to come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our end goal is to come as close as possible to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May our hearts become like the misbah that the Quran talks about. May that light of that lamp be like the iman in our hearts. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this tradition that we are trying to establish in Delaware to bring us as close as possible to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the light of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam becomes a noble tradition, blesses everybody who are part of it. It becomes stronger and stronger. The modern experiments with Islam have failed across the Muslim world, and the conditions of the Muslim world are testimony to the fact that the truth is in the past and we have to go and bring it back. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us in us all the beautiful habits, all the beautiful virtues that He gave Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A Western convert to Islam said something very interesting about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, there is no virtue outside Muhammad. Said there is no virtue outside Muhammad's class. Everything that has value, anything that is worth appreciating, was in the personality of Prophet Muhammad. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thank Him for making us from the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Thank you. Now more on the next segment, I would like to invite our guest from Bazme Khairiya, New Jersey, headed by Sufi Adil Al-Khairi, Sufi Sajjad Shah, Dr. Muhammad Azam, Sufi Abid Malik, and Sufi Amar Al-Khairi.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulil Kareem Amma Baad A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem Bismillahir Rahmanir Raheem Wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen Sadaqa Rasuluhu Nabiyyul Kareem Wa nahnu ala zalika minash shahideena wash shakireen. All praises to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Rabbul Alameen, and salat and salam to His Holy Prophet. For Him, He has stated, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we have not sent you, O Muhammad, except as a mercy to the world. I say welcome to all of you, Jiyanu, if you are Punjabi speakers, Khushamdeed, if you are Urdu speakers, welcome, if you are English speakers, Hoşgeldiniz to my Turkish friends, and Ahlan wa Sahlan Marhaba, if you are from Arabia. I can speak in any of these languages, not Arabic. I feel comfortable in Urdu, but I have started in English because most of the population is here in good English. If we look into the Holy Quran, Allah Ta'ala starts is as with the name of Allah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. It's the Allah's name from which he starts. And he says that Allah is who? He is Rahman, he is Rahim. But when he comes to his prophet, he says he is Rahmatan Lil Alameen. He is the Rahman for whole worlds. After the Surah Fatiha, when we look into Surah Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala differentiates the groups into three groups. Three types of insans. One is Muttaqeen, Hudallil Muttaqeen, and those are the ones who was conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani mu'mineen, Musliman. And then he comes to the second group, those are kafaroon, kafireen, disbelievers. And then he comes to the third group, those are munafiqoon, wa minan nasi man yaqulu amanna. When they come to you, they say that we believe, but when they go to themselves, they say that, oh, we were just visiting them. But when it comes to the Holy Prophet, he says that I have not sent him not only for Muslims, not only for Kafirun, not only for Nafirun, not only for the Muslim Ummah, but it's not only for the human beings, it's for the all of the worlds. Today, we are here to talk about only this one attribute, which is from Arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen. This is the 107th ayah of Surah Anbiya. Surah Anbiya is the surah in which he has mentioned about or glorified one of his best Anbiya's. And then by Saint Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentions, اور ہم نے آپ کو تمام جہانوں کے لیے رحمت ہی بنا کر بھیجا ہے. I will feel more comfortable in Urdu and I can translate into Turkish if you want afterwards. On English, yes, we have heard a lot of English speakers. They have all done a great job. But I see that the most of the community is the Urdu-speaking community. But I can talk to in Urdu afterwards. When we come to the tafsir of this ayah, it's mentioned in tafsir ki koi bhi jin ho ya ins, mumin ho ya kafir, Hazrat Ibn Abbas رضی اللہ تعالی عنہ نے فرمایا کہ حضور کا رحمت ہونا عام ہے ایمان والے کے لیے بھی اور ان کے لیے بھی جو ایمان لا لائے ہو. مومن کے لیے تو آپ دنیا اور آخرت دونوں میں رحمت ہیں, اور جو نا امان جو ایمان نہیں لے کے آیا اس کے لیے آپ اس دنیا میں رحمت ہیں. کیوں؟ کیونکہ آپ کی بدولت ان پر عذاب کی تاخیر ہو رہی ہے. جس طرح پہلی امتوں کے لیے زمین میں دمسانے کا عذاب تھا وہ ان کو نہیں ہو رہا کیونکہ انہوں نے آپ کو بتلایا. جس طرح پہلی امتوں میں لوگوں کی شکلیں بدل دی جاتی تھیں وہ عذاب اس امت میں نہیں ہو رہا کیونکہ حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم ہے. اور اسی طرح جس طرح پہلی امتوں کو بالکل جڑ سے پکڑ کے الٹا دیا جاتا تھا وہ عذاب بھی ہم میں نہیں ہو رہا. تو یہ حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی رحمت ہے جو کفار کے لیے ہے. یہ تھی تفسیر آج کل کے زمانے کی. آیا یہی تفسیر اس سے پہلے بھی تھی؟ تو میں نے دیکھا امام فخر الدین رازی جو کہ 606 ہجری میں فوت ہوئے, آج سے تقریباً 800 سال پہلے, وہ لکھتے ہیں نبی صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم دین میں بھی رحمت ہیں اور دنیا میں بھی رحمت ہیں. دین میں رحمت اس لیے ہے کہ نبی صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو جب بھیجا گیا لوگ جہالت اور گمراہی میں تھے, اور اہل کتاب میں سے یہود و نصاریٰ اپنے دین کے معاملے میں زحمت میں تھے, ان کا اپنی کتابوں میں اختلاف تھا. تو اللہ تعالیٰ نے اس وقت سیدنا محمد مصطفیٰ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو رسول بنا کر بھیجا, اور جب طالب حق کے سامنے نجات کا کوئی راستہ نہ تھا اس وقت آپ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے لوگوں کو حق کی دعوت دی اور نجات کا راستہ دکھایا. اس لیے احکام شریعہ بیان کیے اور حلال اور حرام میں تمیز بتائی. اسی بات کو کہتے ہیں کہ اللہ تعالیٰ اس طرح فرماتا ہے لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. بے شک اللہ تعالیٰ نے مومنوں پر احسان فرمایا جب ان ہی میں سے ایک عظیم رسول بھیج دیا جو ان پر اس کی آیتیں تلاوت کرتا ہے, ان کا باطن صاف کرتا ہے اور ان کو کتاب اور حکمت کی تعلیم دیتا ہے, اور بے شک اس سے پہلے وہ کھلی ہوئی گمراہی میں تھے. دس از دا 164 آیا آف سورہ آل عمران. انگلش ٹرانسلیشن از سرٹنلی ڈیڈ اللہ great favor upon the believers when he sent among them a messenger from themselves, reciting to them his verses and purifying them and teaching them the book and wisdom, although they had been before in manifest errors. تو یہ تو کہتے ہیں کہ یہ تھا کہ جس طرح دین میں جو ہے ہم پہ رحمت ہوئی, تو دنیا میں کس طرح ہم پہ رحمت ہوئی؟ کہ دنیا میں آپ کی طرف سے جو رحمت ہوئی وہ یہ ہے کہ آپ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی وجہ سے ذلت, قتال اور مختلف جنگوں سے لوگوں کو نجات مل گئی. جب ہم دیکھتے ہیں تو حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم سے پہلے ایک چھوٹی چھوٹی بات پر لوگ ہزاروں سال تک لڑتے رہتے تھے اور چیلنج کرتے تھے کہ اس سال تو جا رہے ہیں, اگلے سال پھر آئیں گے, پھر اسی میدان میں دوبارہ لڑائی ہوگی, اور لڑائی جو تھی وہ چھوٹی چھوٹی باتوں پہ جاری رہتی. تو آپ کے دین کی برکت سے اللہ تعالیٰ نے فتح عطا کی مسلمانوں کو, اور وہ جو تھے وہ پھر ایک ہی لوگ جو ہے ایک چیز پہ جمع ہو گئے. مفسرین, اس کے علاوہ بھی بے شمار مفسرین نے اس آیت کی جو ہے وہ تفسیر بیان کی ہے, لیکن وہ سارے اس چیز پہ متفق ہیں کہ حضور محمد مصطفیٰ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم ہر عالم کے لیے رحمت ہیں, خواہ وہ فرشتوں کا جہاں ہو, چاہے وہ جنات کا جہاں ہو, چاہے وہ انسانوں کا عالم ہو. اور انسانوں میں جس طرح کے پہلے بتایا کہ کافر بھی ہیں, مسلمان بھی ہیں, منافق بھی ہیں, ان انسانوں میں اچھے لوگ بھی ہیں, وہ بھی ہیں جو کہ اولیاء اللہ ہیں, اور وہ بھی ہیں جو کہ انبیاء کرام ہیں. تو حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم ان سب کے لیے رحمت ہیں. اسی طرح سرکار حیوانوں کے لیے بھی رحمت ہیں, نباتات کے لیے بھی, جمادات کے لیے بھی رحمت ہیں. جس طرح اللہ تعالیٰ رب العالمین ہے, اور جس کا اللہ تعالیٰ رب ہے, حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم اس کے رحمت ہیں. کیونکہ اللہ تعالیٰ نے جس طرح اپنے آپ کو رب العالمین فرمایا, حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو رحمت للعالمین فرمایا. اللہ تعالیٰ ہر چیز کو عطا کرنے والا ہے, اور حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم اس چیز کو تقسیم کرنے والے ہیں. عطا اللہ کی طرف سے ہوتی ہے لیکن تقسیم حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی طرف سے ہوتی ہے. اس چیز کو اشعار میں ایک شاعر نے کچھ اس طرح کہا, ہونا یہ پھول تو بلبل کا ترنم بھی نہ ہو, چمن طاہر میں کلیوں کا تبسم بھی نہ ہو, یہ نہ ساقی ہو تو میں بھی نہ ہو ہم بھی نہ ہو, بزم توحید میں دنیا میں نہ ہو تم بھی نہ ہو. خیمہ افلاق کا استادہ اسی نام سے ہے, نبض ہستی تبش آمادہ اسی نام سے ہے, تیری نگاہ ناز سے دونوں مراد آ گئے, عقل خیاب و جستجو عشق حضور و اس طرح. متنائے سبل حتم رسول مولا کل جس نے غبار راہ کو بخشا فروغ باد یہ سینہ, نگاہ عشق و مستی میں وہی اول وہی آخر, وہی قرآن وہی فرقان وہی یاسین وہی طٰہٰ. ابھی محترم ڈاکٹر فرما رہے تھے کہ بہترین تفسیر کسی بھی آیت کی یہ ہے کہ اس کو قرآن سے تفسیر بیان کی جائے. تو یہ ایک آیہ کریمہ جس میں حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے کو اللہ تعالیٰ نے رحمت بیان کیا ہے. کیا اللہ تعالیٰ نے اس کی کوئی اور تفسیر بھی بیان کی ہے؟ کیا اللہ تعالیٰ نے کسی اور جگہ پہ بھی حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو رحمت فرمایا ہے؟ تو سورۃ آل عمران کی آیت نمبر 159 اللہ تعالیٰ فرماتے ہیں, فبما رحمت من اللہ لنت لہم ولو کنت فظا غلیظ القلب لانفضوا من حولک. ترجمہ, سو اللہ تعالیٰ کی عظیم رحمت سے آپ مسلمانوں کے لیے نرم ہوگے, اور اگر آپ بد مزاج اور سخت دل ہوتے تو وہ ضرور آپ کے پاس سے بھاگ جاتے. یعنی اللہ تعالیٰ نے حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم پہ رحمت کی, اور اگر آپ اللہ کی رحمت نہ ہوتی تو یہ حضور میں جو نرمی ہے وہ نہ ہوتی. حضرت ابو ہریرہ بیان کرتے ہیں اسی آیت کی تفسیر میں کہ حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کے پاس ایک شخص نے اپنے قرض کی سختی سے تقاضا کیا, آیا اور کہا کہ آپ نے میرا یہ قرض واپس کرنا ہے اور آپ واپس نہیں کر رہے. تو صحابہ کرام نے اس کو ڈانٹنے یا مارنے کا قصد کیا کہ تم کیسے جو ہے ہمارے محبوب کے اوپر اتنی سختی کا بیان کر سکتے ہو, کیسے ان کے ساتھ یہ سخت الفاظ استعمال کر سکتے ہو. تو آپ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے فرمایا, اس کو چھوڑ دو, کیونکہ جس کا حق ہوتا ہے اس کو بات کرنے کی گنجائش ہوتی ہے, کیونکہ میں نے اس کا قرض دینا ہے تو اس کو حق ہے کہ یہ میرے ساتھ سخت بات نہیں کر لے. ایک اور حدیث, یہ حدیث حضرت بخاری نے نقل کی ہے, نسائی نے نقل کی ہے, ترمذی نے نقل کی ہے اور سنن ابن ماجہ میں ہے, یعنی حدیث کی چار مسند کتابوں میں یہ حدیث نقل ہے. ایک دوسری حدیث جس کو حضرت عبداللہ بن مسعود نے نقل کیا ہے, یہ بھی بخاری شریف کی حدیث ہے جس کو مسلم شریف نے بھی نقل کیا ہے. فرماتے ہیں کہ غزوہ حنین میں حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے مال غنیمت تقسیم کرتے ہوئے کچھ لوگوں کو زیادہ مال دیا, تو اقرا بن حابس کو 100 اونٹ دیے اور اینیا کو بھی اتنے ہی دیے, اور عرب کے جو سردار تھے ان کو دوسرے لوگوں سے کچھ زیادہ عطا فرمایا, اور اس دن آپ نے تقسیم میں بعض لوگوں کو ترجیح دی, یعنی بعض لوگوں کو زیادہ مال دیا بعض لوگوں کو کم مال دیا. تو ایک شخص نے کہا کہ اس تقسیم میں عدل نہیں کیا گیا اور نام اس میں اللہ کی رضا کا ارادہ کیا گیا ہے. یعنی لوگ باتوں آپس میں کرنے لگے اور ایک بندے نے یہ بات کہہ دی. تو کہتے ہیں عبداللہ بن مسعود کہ میں نے کہا, اللہ کی قسم میں یہ بات ضرور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو خبر دوں گا, یہ میں بات جا کے حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو بتاؤں گا, اور پھر میں نے جا کر آپ کو خبر دی. تو آپ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے فرمایا, جب اللہ اور اس کا رسول عدل نہیں کریں گے تو پھر اور کون عدل کرے گا؟ اللہ حضرت موسیٰ علیہ السلام پر رحم فرمائے, ان کو اس سے زیادہ عذاب دی گئی, یعنی ان کو اس سے زیادہ تکلیف دی گئی, تو انہوں نے صبر کیا. تو کہتے ہیں کہ یہ کیوں ہوا؟ اس لیے کہ بعض دفعہ jo nemat bande musalman hote the to huzur nabi akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam ki taleef ek alag ke liye unko kuch zyada maal dete the aur hadith time ki kami ki wajah se sirf do hadith aur do quran ayat ka hawala dunga aur baat karunga حضرت عائشہ صدیقہ رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ سے روایت ہے صحیح مسلم کی حدیث ہے کہ فرماتی ہے کہ رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے جہاد کے سوا کبھی کسی کو نہیں مارا جہاد کے سوا کبھی کسی کو نہیں مارا کسی عورت پر حق کبھی ہاتھ نہیں اٹھایا اور نہ کبھی کسی خادم کو مارا یہی حضرت عائشہ صدیقہ روایت کرتی ہیں ام المؤمنین صحیح بخاری صحیح مسلم ابو داؤد اور ترمذی شریف میں یہ حدیث ہے کہ میں نے رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو کبھی کسی زیادتی کا بدلہ لیتے ہوئے نہیں دیکھا یعنی اگر کوئی بندہ حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم سے کوئی زیادتی کر دیتا کوئی غلط بات یا کوئی سخت بات کہہ دیتا تو میں نے رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کو کبھی کسی زیادتی کا بدلہ لیتے ہوئے نہیں دیکھا سوا اس کے کہ اللہ کی حدود کو پامال کیا جائے جب اللہ کی حد توڑی جاتی تو آپ سب سے زیادہ غضبناک ہوتے اور آپ کو جب بھی دو چیزوں میں سے کسی ایک چیز کا اختیار دیا جاتا تو آپ آسان چیز کو اختیار کرتے بشرطے کہ وہ گناہ نہ ہو یعنی دو چیزیں ہوتی کہ یہ راستہ ہے اور یہ راستہ ہے تو اگر ایک راستے پہ گناہ کا احتمال نہ ہوتا تو جو مشکل راستہ ہوتا اس کو چھوڑ دیتے اور صرف آسانی کا راستہ اختیار کرتے اللہ تعالیٰ حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کے لیے جو ہے وہ پوچھتے ہیں دوسرے مذہب والوں سے یا دوسرے دین والوں سے اور ان میں سے سورت عراف کی آیت ہے جو ان سے ان کے مشکل احکام کے بوجھ اتارے گا اور ان کے گلے میں پڑے ہوئے سختیوں کے طور اتار کر پھینک دے گا یعنی ایک ایسا نبی آنے والا ہے وَيَدَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِسْرَاهُمْ جو ان سے ان کے مشکل بوجھ اتار پھینکے گا ایک ایسا نبی آئے گا کل اگلے جہان نیکسٹ ٹائم میں وہ نبی کیا کرے گا کہ وہ لوگوں کے گلے میں جو مشکل بوجھ ڈلے ہوئے ہیں وہ اتار دے گا تو ہمارے نبی وہ ہیں جو ہمارے بوجھوں کو اتارنے کے لیے آئے اور پھر سورۃ اعراف میں اللہ تعالیٰ فرماتے ہیں الذین یتبعون الرسول النبی الامی الذی وہ لوگ جو اس عظیم رسول نبی امی کی پیروی کریں گے جس کو وہ اپنے پاس تورات اور انجیل میں لکھا ہوا پاتے ہیں جو ان کو نیکی کا حکم دے گا اور برائی سے روکے گا جو ان کے لیے پاکیزہ چیزوں کو حلال کرے گا اور ان پر ناپاک چیزوں کو حرام کرے گا جو ان سے مشکل احکام کے بوجھ اتارے گا اور ان کے گلے میں پڑے ہوئے سختیوں کے طور اتار پھینکے گا ہمارے نبی وہ ہیں جو ہمارے لیے یہ ساری چیزیں ہمارے لیے آسان کرنے کے لیے اور پھر حضور کی رحمت کے متعلق سورۃ توبہ کی آیت نمبر 138 لقد جاءکم رسول من انفسکم عزیز علیہ ما عنتم حریص علیکم بالمؤمنین رؤوف الرحیم بے شک تمہارے پاس تم میں سے ایک عظیم رسول آگئے ہیں تمہارا مشقت میں پڑنا ان پر بہت شوق ہے تمہاری فلاح پر وہ بہت حریص ہیں اور مومنوں پر بہت شفیق اور نہایت مہربان اللہ تعالی ہمیں حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی زندگی کے واقعات کو قرآن سے اور حدیث سے سن کر ان پر عمل کرنے کی توفیق عطا فرمائے یہ جو میں نے بیان کیا یہ صرف ایک باب ہے اس آیت کی تفسیر کا کہ قرآن پاک میں یا حدیث کے کچھ واقعات میں حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کے متعلق کیا بیان کیا گیا اس کے علاوہ کہ حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کفار پہ کس طرح رحمت ہیں اس کے متعلق حدیث کا پورا ایک باب ہے حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے حیوانات پہ کیا کیا مہربانیاں کی اس کے متعلق پورا ایک باب ہے حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے فرشتوں پر کس طرح مہربانیاں کی, اس کا پورا ایک باب ہے. حضور نبی اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے نباتات پہ جمادات پہ کس طرح مہربانیاں کی, اس کا پورا ایک باب ہے. تو انشاءاللہ وقت ملا تو پھر کبھی وہ باتیں آگے پیش کریں گے. تو میں صوفی عادل صاحب بھی پیش کرتا ہوں جس طرح سرکار.
بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. الحمدللہ رب العالمین حمد الشاکرین صلی اللہ علی حبیبہ محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ اجمعین. عزیز سامعین, اللہ تبارک و تعالی کا احسان عظیم ہے کہ اس نے ہمیں اور آپ کو آج اس خوبصورت تقریب سعید میں جمع فرمایا ہے. اور جمع ہونے کا مقصد صرف اور صرف یہ ہے کہ کچھ دیر بیٹھ کر اللہ اور اس کے حبیب کے ذکر سے اپنے دلوں کو روشن کر لیں. حضور کی تعلیمات کے اوپر ہماری بچیوں نے بہت خوبصورت انداز میں اپنی محبت کے نذرانے پیش کیے. اسی طرح محترم ڈاکٹر صاحب اور ڈاکٹر اعظم صاحب نے بڑے خوبصورت انداز میں حضور کی محبت اور آپ کی تعلیمات کے اوپر گفتگو فرمائی. اگر ہم دیکھتے ہیں کہ نبی پاک علیہ الصلوۃ والسلام کی تمام ظہری حیات مبارکہ, آپ ارشاد فرماتے ہیں کہ اس پوری کائنات میں سب سے زیادہ جس نے اللہ کا ذکر کیا وہ حضور کی ذات ہے, اور جس کا سب سے زیادہ ذکر ہوا اور ہوگا وہ بھی حضور کی ذات. نبی پاک علیہ الصلوۃ والسلام مدینہ شریف میں مسجد نبوی میں تشریف فرما تھے. صحابہ اکرام کثیر تعداد میں آپ کے پاس موجود تھے, اور صحابہ حضور سے سوالات کر کے اپنے معاملات پیش فرما رہے تھے کہ ایک عربی صحابی حضور کی بارگاہ میں حاضر ہوئے اور انہوں نے عرض کی کہ یا رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم, قیامت کب آئے گی؟ تو حضور نے ارشاد فرمایا کہ اے میرے صحابی, وہ تو بہت بڑا دن ہے, کیا اس کے لیے کوئی تیاری کی ہے آپ نے؟ تو عرض کی یا رسول اللہ, تیاری تو نہیں کی, لیکن ایک بات ہے کہ مجھے اللہ اور اس کے حبیب کے ساتھ محبت ہے. تو حضور نے ارشاد فرمایا کہ یہ یاد رکھو, ایک بڑی مختصر سی بڑی خوبصورت بات حدیث مبارک آپ نے ارشاد فرمائی کہ المرء ما من احبا, کہ یاد رکھو کہ اس دنیا میں جو جس سے محبت کرے گا کل قیامت والے دن اسی کے ساتھ ہوگا. تو یہ سب سے بڑی جو گارنٹی ہے ہمارے ساتھ کہ ہم بیٹھ کر حضور کی محبت کو اپنے قلوب میں اتار رہے ہیں, اور اس بات کا یقین ہمیں حضور کی اس حدیث مبارک سے ہو گیا کہ آج ہم حضور کی محبت میں اپنی زندگی گزارنے کا عہد کر رہے ہیں, تو کل قیامت والے دن بھی ہمیں حضور کا ساتھ ملے گا. بزرگان دین ارشاد فرماتے ہیں کہ چونکہ حضور کی تمام حیات مبارکہ اللہ کے ذکر سے مزین ہے, آپ سفر میں ہیں, مکہ میں ہیں, مدینہ میں ہیں, تو جہاں بھی تشریف فرما ہے ہر وقت اللہ تعالیٰ کی یاد میں مشغول ہیں. اس لیے اس کی وجہ کیا ہے کہ تین چیزیں حضور نے ارشاد فرمایا کہ یہ دلوں کو پاک کرنے کے لیے اللہ تعالیٰ نے تین چیزوں کے بارے میں فرمایا, تین حکم فرمائے ہیں. سب سے پہلے دل کو پاک کرنے کے لیے فرمایا کہ قرآن کی تلاوت کی جائے. پھر ارشاد فرمایا کہ موت کو یاد رکھا جائے, جب انسان موت کو یاد رکھتا ہے تو پھر کوشش کرتا ہے کہ زیادہ سے زیادہ اللہ تعالیٰ کی بندگی اختیار کرے. تیسری چیز فرمایا کہ زیادہ کثرت کے ساتھ اللہ کا ذکر کیا جائے، کیونکہ اللہ کے ذکر سے دل کی پاکی حاصل ہوتی ہے، اور دل جب پاک ہوتا ہے تو پھر انسان کی سوچ اور فکر میں تبدیلی آ جاتی ہے. اس لیے گفتگو تو ہم نے سنی اور کی، عملی طور پہ تھوڑی دیر بیٹھ کر ہم ذکر کریں گے. مختصر سا ختم شریف ہے، کچھ پرانی آیات ہیں، دعاؤں کے مجموعات ہیں، وہ پڑھے جائیں گے. تمام خواتین و حضرات سے گزارش ہے کہ ہمارے ساتھ شامل ہو جائیں. ایک مرتبہ ہاتھ اٹھا کے فاتحہ شریف. بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، الحمدللہ رب العالمین، الرحمن الرحیم، مالک یوم الدین، اياك نعبد واياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين انعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. درود پاک صلى الله على حبيبه محمد واله وصحبه وسلم. صلى الله على حبيبه محمد واله وصحبه وسلم. سورة لم نشرح. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي انقض ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك فإن مع العسر يسرا إن مع العسر يسرا فإذا فرغت فانصب إلى ربك فارغب. سورة إخلاص.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. فاتحة شريف. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. درود پاک
صلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.
صلى الله على حبيبه محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. صلى الله على حبيبه محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. آية كريمة.
لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين.
درود پاک
صلى الله على حبيبه محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.
صلى الله على حبيبه محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. صلى الله على حبيبه محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. كلمة طيبة. لا إله
رافع الدرجات
یا مجیب الدعوات
مجيب
الدعوات يا امان الخائفين
يا امان الخائفين
يا خير الناصرين
يا خير الناصرين
يا دليل المتحيرين
يا دليل المتحيرين
يا غياث المستغيثين اغثنا
يا غياث المستغيثين اغثنا
يا مفرح المحزونين
يا مفرح المحزونين
ربي اني مغلوب فانتصر
ربي اني مغلوب فانتصر
يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا رحم الراحمين
يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا رحم الراحمين
سبحان الله
سبحان الله الحمد لله لا اله الا الله والله اكبر ولا حول ولا قوه الا بالله العلي العظيم
اللهم استرني بصدرك الجميل
اللهم استرني بصدرك الجميل
پاک
صلى الله على حبيب محمد وعلى وصحبه وسلم صلى الله على حبيب محمد وعلى وصحبه وسلم صلى الله على حبيب محمد وعلى وصحبه وسلم
اللهم ربنا امين 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 برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين الحمدللہ ہم نے ختم شریف پڑھا تھوڑی دیر کے لیے ہم اللہ کے ذکر میں شامل ہوں گے پہلے نفی اثبات لا الہ الا اللہ کا ذکر کیا جائے گا یہ ذکر فرشتوں کا ذکر ہے کیونکہ ان کے ساتھ کوئی نفسانی خواہشات نہیں ہیں ان کو جب بھی بھوک لگتی ہے تو وہ اللہ کا ذکر کرتے ہیں یہ فرشتوں کا ذکر ہے تمام دوست محبت کے ساتھ ہمارے ساتھ ذکر کر لیں لا الہ الا اللہ
لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ لا الہ الا اللہ
محمد رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم الا اللہ الا اللہ
الله 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 ال
کیسے حاصل ہوگی؟ تو آپ نے فرمایا کہ زیادہ سے زیادہ جن کی آوازیں اچھی ہوں ان سے حضور کا ذکر سنا جائے، تو یہ بڑا آسان ذریعہ ہے کہ آپ کے دلوں میں حضور کی محبت اجاگر ہو۔ تو اسی نظریے سے ہم دعوت دیتے ہیں ہمارے چھوٹے نعت خوان ہیں مصطفیٰ خیری صاحب، وہ تشریف لاتے ہیں اور آقا کی بارگاہ میں اپنی محبت کا نذرانہ پیش فرماتے ہیں۔ تمام دوست محبت سے درود شریف پڑھ لیجیے۔ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم۔